Hi there, everyone. Thank you for joining me for another chat. There are a few things I wanted to say today. First of all, you have probably heard that we've had a bit of a heat wave here in the UK. It's not as hot today as it has been the last few days, certainly the last couple of days. But if you hear a whirring noise in the background while I'm speaking to you, it's not a dark entity or anything. I've got a little fan in here, and it's really difficult to sit and talk to you without a fan on. My room, my little office where I do all my recording, is probably the coolest room in the house, but it's still quite warm in here, so I need the fan on. I have these curtains that are made of like scarves. I have them closed all the time, so I don't have sun coming in all the time. So this room stays quite cool. However, I have got the fan on, and I'd also like to say my dog is in this room with me on the floor. He's been desperately looking for somewhere to go in this hot weather. He's been groomed, so he's got a nice short coat and he's very comfortable, and we have fans on in all the rooms, but he likes coming in here because this is the coolest room. So he's under my feet. So I might have to stop and let him out at some point while I'm talking. So I apologize for that. The other thing I want to mention before I start talking is I have had, and I'm at the tail end of a summer cold. And so I did lose my voice, and it's taken a while for my voice to come back. If you look at my last sort of three, possibly four videos, if you really listen, you can tell that I have a summer cold and that my voice is not 100%. Clever editing from Cat's Magic made the voice just about okay to do a recording. But if you listen carefully, you can actually tell that my voice is not up to scratch. So I hope my voice holds out for this video. If not, I will have to end and then carry on talking about what I want to talk about at a later stage. Before I get into the topic, though, I just wanted to touch upon the novel that I'm writing, The Bifurcated Village, and I just wanted to discuss Gloria. So I myself, Magenta Pixie, have a summer cold, but Gloria, a couple of weeks ago, she actually got quite ill, and she had what she felt was the flu-y flu-flu. It's really similar to the flu that we have here in the real world. And that's what she had, the flu-y flu-flu and all the symptoms. But there is a testing pool in the village. You just get inside the pool, you sit down, and the pool will tell you if you have the kookyruru or not. And Gloria didn't think she had the kookyruru, as it was nothing like when she had the kookyruru back in October, but she got in the pool anyway, just out of interest. More really to see the accuracy of the pool itself rather than whether she had kooky or not. And she did test in the pool positive for the kookyruru. So she took that on board, but what she did was she empathically tuned in on what was going on with her body and this bug or pathogen, if you will, and looking at all the components of it while she was going through this flu-y flu-flu experience, which was typical flu-y flu-flu, the temperature, the headache, the you know, coming in stages, the aching, typical flu-y flu-flu. Now, the difference is with the kookyruru, which she had last year, there was a very, very different energetic feel. That was more of this hallucinogenic, AI, computerized kind of hypnotic suggestion, which I have spoken about, the nine have spoken about this as well. There is a video that I have called Integrating and Understanding Moronic Sequence. So if you have a listen to that, that sort of shows you the pathogenic makeup of kookyruru. And this was more of a tropical kind of feel, like a tropical illness, quite different. And also, I have spoken about there is a serpent in the village, and some of the liquid that the serpent gives to the villagers is utilized within the original computerized creation, which the Nine spoke to me about right back at the beginning of 2020, if you remember when they showed me the serpent. So we are discussing fiction here in the fictional novel. So it is my conclusion from my personal experience and from communication with the Nine and from empathically tuning in on this type of pathogenic sequence, that there is an actual Kukiruru in the village. So you will hear people say that there is no such thing as Kukiruru in the village. Some of the Fae in the village don't believe in Kukiruru and think that the Flooey Flu Flu has been completely hijacked and other things that are similar to the Flooey Flu Flu. So there's truth here in both, because there is a Kukiruru that's been engineered by the overlords, and it is like an artificial intelligence, computerized, pathogenic, created, spliced, hybrid pathogen, pathogenic sequence, the Nine call it. But I feel that there were not enough numbers in the village amongst the fairies and the pixies and the elves to actually create the presentation of something that is going to be profound throughout the whole village and affect everyone. There weren't enough numbers amongst the Fae. So on top of the actual Kukiruru, the Flooey Flu Flu has been hijacked, and similar things to the Flooey Flu Flu. So when you get into the pond to test if you have Kukiruru, that pond is going to show you a positive test result, even if you have the Flooey Flu Flu. So that's my assumption. And this is why you find within the village, some people will say there's no such thing as Kukiruru. It's completely hijacked. The Flooey Flu Flu has been hijacked. And other people will say that is not true. There is a Kukiruru. It's nothing like anything I've ever experienced before. It's completely different. It has this tropical kind of energy about it, this sort of wild energy about it, and this artificial energy about it. Both of these people are correct. And with flags of the false kind in my fictional novel, there is always a truthful element and a hijacked false element within the flag of the false kind scenario. That's how they manage to hijack everyone, including those who feel that they are standing in awareness of truth. So it is my opinion, and I have spoken to the Nine about this. I haven't had a full confirmation of this from the Nine. They're allowing me to explore this still, and I'm still exploring this, but it's my feeling at this point that there is a Kukiruru, which it has been confirmed by the Nine. There is a Kukiruru. What hasn't been confirmed by the Nine is that Flooey Flu Flu has been hijacked. This is my assumption at this moment, and I'm in communication with the Nine about that issue at the moment. So right now, that is my feeling, that it's both. There is a Kukiruru and the Flooey Flu Flu has been hijacked, and the pond is presenting a positive result regardless of what that is. Okay, so yes, that's Gloria. She tested for the Kukiruru on a positive yet again, but it was very, very different. Was Gloria a little bit nervous because of what happened to her before, as she had the Kukiruru so badly and she had to go into the village medical center? Yes, slightly. But when Gloria tuned in fully upon herself and what was happening, she felt that that nervousness went away because she could feel that this was so different. This time also, Gloria was able to get up and walk around the village every day. She was able to walk around her straw hut and her little garden regularly. When she had the Kukiruru last year, she couldn't do that. She literally couldn't get out of bed for more than a few seconds. And then she had to just get back into bed because her breath was not available for her to be able to move around. She was low on oxygen and she had extremely low energy. So things are different this time, which makes Gloria feel that this is the flu. Now, obviously, there is the possibility that this immunity has kicked in from the original Kukiruru, creating a much milder experience. And Gloria took that into account in the novel, in the fictional novel. What is making her feel that that's not the case, and this genuinely was flu, is the difference in this frequency. No energy of AI, no energy of this hypnotic suggestion, no energy of this hybrid spliced AI pathogenic sequence. This was this seemed to be an organic flu. The same structure as the organic flu that's been in the village for many, many years. The Kukiruru is different. So that's my assumption. And that's what Gloria in the novel thinks. Okay, let's get into what I wanted to talk about today. So I've got a few topics here. Now, the first thing I'd like to discuss is in the last couple of videos, I have spoken and the nine have spoken about being the observer and bearing witness to what is occurring within the village. We are discussing fiction, as I have said. So as you view the village and all the domains within the village, the overlords, the fae, everything, as you view that structure, you become the observer without identifying with the emotions that being the observer would bring up, as in someone looking at that situation, without identifying with emotions that could pull you away from your center and make you become one with the incident that's occurring. That doesn't mean you don't feel compassion, but you're bearing witness to this entire situation. And a few people, it was clear by their messages on my social media, a few people did not understand what this meant. And they were kind of taking this as somewhat of a negative thing towards them, an insult, really. Being the observer meant sitting there and watching everyone suffering and you not feeling anything because you're fine sitting there in your chair, watching it all play out and not being any part of it. That's absolutely not what being the observer and bearing witness means at all. So before I get into the main subject matter of this video, I just want to read to you a status that I did post on my social media after really releasing those last couple of videos, just explaining what being the observer and bearing witness actually means. So this is what I wrote. Being the observer or bearing witness appears to be misunderstood by some. This does not mean sit in a chair, stare at the TV and watch people suffer across the world, across the village, while you sit comfortably at home in your hut. This is a third dimensional interpretation and it is false and it is erroneous. Being the observer and bearing witness does not mean you do not participate in reality. It simply means you are not emotionally invested in the crash and fall of the third dimension and all the dramas that come with that. Let me just clarify that statement, which I didn't clarify in the status. The crash and fall of the third dimension, what I mean by that is the crash and the fall of the system that is set up within the third dimension. That does not mean the third dimension itself is crashing and falling. However, when you're in the fourth dimension and certainly in the fifth dimension, and you perceive from that viewpoint, you will perceive the third dimension as crashing and falling. It isn't. It's remaining in place. It's the system that's crashing and falling. Okay, just wanted to clarify that. You still feel compassion for those who are suffering. Bearing witness and observing does not mean you will not have challenges within your life that could lead to an experience of suffering. It does not mean you will not watch family members and loved ones go through challenges and enter a state of suffering themselves. You observe and bear witness, but you still take action to alleviate your own potential suffering and the suffering of others. Observation and bearing witness is a spiritual path. It cannot be categorized by third dimensional thinking. Just checking we're still recording. You may see 5 homeless, hungry people, and 4 may be experiencing that reality in the third dimension. And the 5th one may be bearing witness and observing and is therefore experiencing reality from a 5th dimensional standpoint. Yes, it's less likely that the 5D thinking individual lines up with such an experience in the first place, due to the fact that they're not caught up in identification of the drama and therefore will not create a match to that in their reality. Yet in some cases, they may move through the same experience as others, yet their personal experience of that event or situation will not be the same. The wave of change touches everyone. No one is immune from it. So please do not confuse the ability to be the observer with someone who just sits back and watches the suffering of others whilst munching popcorn and enjoying the show. The observer moves through the sine waves of challenges like everyone else. They just experience them differently because they think differently. The observer is not just bearing witness to the collapse and fall of the 3D reality, but also is observing the multidimensional interactions. It's the only way to navigate reality at this time. If you do not have the ability to be the observer, then you will find yourself caught up in the dramas of the 3D collapse and all that that entails. The observer, through their ability to choose the emotion they wish to experience, creates their own reality even within a hijacked reality. They become masters of their own emotional state and thus the created match within their lives. This is not elitist or anything to do with finance or privilege of birth circumstance. This is a spiritual discipline offered to each and every soul at this time. So I hope that clarifies to anyone who thinks that being an observer means watching other people suffer while you don't. That's absolutely not what it means. Okay, so let's get on to the main subject matter of this video, which is I'm going to talk about the grey alien hybrid, and I'm going to discuss the great solar flash or the flash of light. Okay, so the first one is a status I wrote just today, actually. Okay, yeah, I wrote this today as I'm being asked a lot of questions about grey alien hybrids lately. So information about the grey alien hybrid extraterrestrial species is being put out there, and I'm being asked questions about what's being said. So this was the status I wrote this morning. I'm being asked a lot of questions about grey alien hybrid entities lately, suggesting they are somehow out there as truth leaders, as in the grey alien hybrids are the truth leaders. That's what's being asked of me, is if this is true. And these truth leaders have big followings, and they're offering to activate or upgrade your DNA for you for large sums of money. So what I'm being asked, I mean, I asked lots of questions about grey alien hybrids, but this one particular question is, are the grey alien hybrids out there as truth leaders with big followings offering to activate or upgrade your DNA for you for large sums of money? So this is what I replied. Firstly, it's absolutely correct that no one can upgrade your DNA for you or activate you. Now, guidance can be given for this. Codes, keys, triggers, encryptions can be passed to others in the form of writing, both in fact and fiction, artwork, music, movement, etc. But these are triggers into your own memory, your own DNA system. No one should be telling you that they can remotely activate your DNA for you for large sums of money. That's not how it works. So if someone is saying to you, you give me this amount of money and I will go on home and activate your DNA for you, you activate your own DNA. Yes, people can pass energy to others. They can send healing to others remotely. We know that that works. But when it comes to the activation of the DNA, the moving into the light body, the moving from the carbon base to the crystalline molecular structure, and upgrading your chakras or whatever this, whatever the person is saying, those things are all done by you. And they can either be done consciously or they occur naturally with the movement of this organic energy that we are in right now. So obviously be discerning if someone is suggesting that they can do this for you. So no one should be remotely activating your DNA for large sums of money, okay? However, these people that are doing this are not gray alien hybrids. They are unscrupulous or ungrounded humans, but they are not gray alien hybrids. So I go on to say, the gray alien hybrid cannot incarnate into a human vehicle. That is absolute. The nine have told me this for a long, long time. The gray alien hybrid cannot incarnate into a human vehicle. Now, this is what the JUICE program is all about. The long-term plan is to create compatible human vehicles for these entities. And I've spoken about this in previous videos. You can go back and have a look at those. The last couple of talks that I did, I discussed this. I discussed this in the Roe versus Wade talk that I did. That's the JUICE program. It's not the absolute reason for the JUICE program. There are multiple agendas within that. But one of the bigger agendas within the JUICE program is to create this compatible human vehicle for these entities to incarnate into. Now, the gray alien hybrid cannot take over your body or your soul or anything like that. However, the gray alien hybrid, which is a fourth dimensional entity, could potentially influence a human if the conditions were right. So it is possible that some of these unscrupulous individuals charging large sums of money for DNA activations are being influenced by these beings from the fourth dimension. Now, perhaps this is where the confusion comes from, as different channels, psychics, spiritual teachers, etc., use different terminology to explain different concepts. So it might be, I don't know, I haven't heard anyone say this, but it might be that someone is interpreting that fourth dimensional influence over a human as that human actually being a gray alien hybrid. They're not that, but they could be being influenced. It's a subtle difference, but a really important difference. It's also correct that there are positive beings also known as the gray alien hybrid, and these are different beings. There are so many different types of hybrid entities, it's actually really impossible to comment on what another speaker or spiritual teacher has said without directly communicating with that person in order to clarify what they mean by these different terms. So if whoever it is that is saying this information, if anyone has said this information, it could be that people are misinterpreting what they're saying. But if somebody has actually said this without me actually speaking to them, saying, right, what did you mean when you said this? What does this person mean by gray alien hybrid? What does this person mean by them being in the truth community and having big followings? And, you know, what is this person meaning? Because everyone has different interpretations of different words and terminology and situations. Another thing to mention is that beings from other planetary systems and dimensions do not like being called an alien. It's actually a derogatory term. It's seen as offensive to many 4D entities. Fifth dimensional entities don't get offended, but fourth dimensional entities can. So alien is offensive, whether you're talking to a negative being or a positive being. Alien is not what they are from their perspective. You know, it's like calling us an alien. An extraterrestrial or an ultra-dimensional or a celestial being, a planetary being, a galactic being, an off-world being, all of those are far more respectful than saying alien. It's actually seen as derogatory in galactic circles. I also have people saying that other speakers are not psychics, they're emissaries. They're not channels, but they are receiving downloads. They're not clairvoyant, but they're using kelontic science, is one that I've heard, or telepathy or monadic communication, or they're visiting the ships in the astral or the physical or the dream time or the waking space, etc., etc. So all these different people who are accessing this metaphysical information, this out-of-the-box non-linear information, are presenting in different ways. A psychic, an emissary, a channel, they're receiving downloads, they're clairvoyant, they're using kelontic science or telepathy or monadic communication, or they're visiting the ships in the astral or the physical or dream time or waking space, and they're communicating with these beings, or whatever they may say to you that they are doing in order to access this information. Please, may I say, in order to clear up the confusion, that all these things are the same. They are the same thing. So, I mean, you know, I see arguments, oh, this person's not a channel. This person is a ambassador for this council and goes on the ships and communicates with them. Oh, this person isn't a channel. This person has been abducted or is an experiencer, or whatever they may say is occurring with them. And I'm not saying that they're not accurate. I'm not saying that they're telling lies. I'm saying that all these things are exactly the same. They're the same thing. And I will explain further. All these individuals operate from a more expansive brainwave state. That's it. That's what's happening with me. You know, I could call myself a channel, an emissary. I could be a galactic ambassador for a council. I'm using monadic communication for sure, kelontic science, telepathy. I'm visiting the ships. I go on the ships. I talk to the ETs. You know, I go through vortices and space tunnels and I speak to different beings. All of this, I'm doing all of it. I simply just call it channeling, because that's the name I give for it. But it's all the same thing. These individuals operate from a more expansive brainwave state. The hemispheres of the brain are more balanced, as in some people will have a more activated right hemisphere and not so much the left and vice versa. These people who are doing this have more of a balanced right and left hemisphere of the brain in the waking state and in the dream time. So the hemispheres of the brain are more balanced and more activated. So more of the brain is being used, and that includes the body, mind, and the DNA and everything within that. It's not just the brain. The brain is the interface for all of that. So the hemispheres of the brain are more balanced and more activated than the average person. Their brains have become cosmic antennas and receivers, if you will. Now, how they subjectively experience this change in brainwave state may be very different. They may perceive themselves to be channeling, or in a state of telepathy, or receiving downloads, or going onto the ships, acting as an ambassador or an emissary for a galactic high council. Now, this is important, whether that galactic high council be the Galactic Federation of Light, or the Federation of Worlds, or the Confederation of Planets, It really makes no difference within the subjective experience of the individual. It makes no difference. There's a lot of information out there saying Galactic Federation of Light's the negative one and the Galactic Federation of Worlds is the positive one. The Confederation of the Planets is the real one. There's some truth to this when it comes to actual extraterrestrial councils. But when it comes to the subjective experience of the individual, it really makes no difference what they're calling their council. It's all the same thing. So flying their own Merkaba ship, visiting other planets, drawing down the higher self, becoming a walk-in, astral traveling. Now the subjective experience of astral traveling and being a walk-in and flying a Merkaba ship, completely different. It's the brainwave state activating in these different ways that the nine called the beyond the theta brainwave state, the going galactic. The brain is working in this different way, in this activated way, and the subjective interpretation of what's happening is a subjective interpretation. Now, that's not to say it's not accurate, but all of these things are the same within the human makeup. So astral travel, astral communication, it's all the same thing. It's a subjective interpretation of the expansive brainwave state I'm talking about, and that takes time to integrate. It takes time to realize what's happening. The reason why I call what I do channeling is because that's how I subjectively experienced it, a communication with a spirit guide. And the spirit guide then upgraded into these white winged beings. So then I am channeling angels, if you will, or a galactic council of angelic beings. It took time, in fact, for me, many years before I realized it was subjective what I was experiencing. Now that subjective experience isn't not real. It's real, but it is a presentation of what is occurring within the galactic antimatter sphere and within your own mind and your own DNA. It's a unity with your environment and it's experienced subjectively with each individual. But some of these individuals interpret what they're doing so literally that they see what they're doing as something completely different to what someone else is doing, to the point where they will say, I'm not doing that. That's actually dangerous. That's a bad thing. I'm doing the good bit. But they're all doing the same thing. And the arguments that I'm seeing, on social media, this person isn't actually channeling. This person gets their information from astral downloaded packages or whatever the phrase may be. It's the same thing. It's an activated brainwave state. And all the star seeds are doing it one way or another. It's higher creativity. And it, expands on from there. It's the ability to transcend linear time and see the past, the present, and the future as one. And to see multiple timelines and multiple dimensions. So the subjective experience of what the individual goes through is simply that, their subjective experience. It doesn't mean that they're different or worse or better than somebody else. And there's so many arguments about this in the spiritual community and not so much in the truth community because they don't talk so much about this, but it's there as well. And we are all on the same team, every single one of us, even if we don't agree with one another's information, we're all on the same team. We're all doing the same job. So we really need to unify and come together now more than we ever have. But I'm going off track here. So I go on to say, this takes time to integrate. These things are not literal in the physical sense. They may feel very real to the experiencer. They're metaphors to explain the brainwave configuration. They are flame letters, fire letters. They are a cosmic alphabet. What you see, what you experience is all part of that awakening. And as I've said so many times before, a speaker or a teacher might have some really good, really accurate information, but may not be interpreting that information in the best way they could be, or interpreting what they're doing in order to receive that information. They haven't yet learned how to be objective regarding their own subjectivity. And that's the issue, and that ties in with the last status. Be the observer, bear witness, not just to what's happening in the village, what's happening throughout the world in all domains. Be objective and be the observer to your own subjective experience. It is the only way you will find accuracy of what is happening, is if you do not identify emotionally with what you are doing and how you access that information, because then you become emotionally attached to it and will defend it if it is attacked. If you are objective to it, if you are bearing witness to it, you see more of what it is. And that's how come I know now that all this is the same thing, because I became objective to my own subjectivity. So I'll say that again. They have not yet learned how to be objective regarding their own subjectivity. It is massive and crucial and so, so important to understand this. They are interpreting in the best way that they know how. So you, as the listener or the reader of this information, you have to do the interpreting regarding any information that you come across. You, as the listener or the reader of this information, need to be extremely discerning and a good interpreter of frequency experienced subjectively by another without judging the individual messenger. So you listen to someone. Now, if you don't resonate with what they're saying, if you're in an observer viewpoint and you're in non-judgment, that's fine. You don't resonate. That's good to understand that you're not resonating. But so many will then cast the sort of negative assumption upon that person by saying, oh, they're channeling false light, they're channeling AI, they're really a grey hybrid alien or a reptilian or whatever they may call that person. That's judging the individual messenger. You can be discerning about their information, and you can be an interpreter of the frequency that is experienced subjectively by them. It's like someone telling you their dream and telling you that their dream is literal and real. And you sit there, take on board the dream, but interpret it. Otherwise, you throw the baby out with the bathwater. And you miss the gems within that information. Every messenger out there has a gem in there somewhere and has information for you. Even though you might reject 90% of what they're saying, 10% could be life-changing. So all of this pointing the finger at all of these different spiritual teachers and psychics and channels about what they're doing, how they're doing it, which one's more accurate, which one is better, is so divisive when we need to be unified. And that noise right now is my little dog who's trying to get under my feet. Are you all right, Scampi? You okay? Okay, he's moved now. I hope this clarifies a lot of the recent questions about these topics and will assist you in your communications with other ascending awakening individuals, as I see many arguments about this where both parties are actually correct. So I will see these people argue, and they're both speaking truth and having a go at one another for the other person being wrong. It's that whole thing about, you know, if you couldn't see and you were looking at a giant elephant, and the only way you could tell what that elephant is like to another person is by touching the elephant, and one person says, well, this elephant is really sort of, you know, round and big because it's their leg. Well, no, they're not. They're long and sort of curly like a snake. Well, that's the trunk. No, they're not. They're small and fluffy, and because that's the tail. And they're all right. They're all touching the same animal. That's exactly what's happening in the spiritual and to a high degree in the truth community. So I end this status by saying understanding semantics is paramount if you are to converse in the metaphysical field. So go and look up semantics. If you don't know what it means, go and Google semantics or DuckDuckGo semantics, whatever you want to do, and learn about what semantics is. And that will really assist you in your communication. within the metaphysical, spiritual, truth world. Okay, so the next part of this is going to be questions that I've had come into me, but I've kind of put those questions into one as they're all in a similar vein and presented them to the nine. I have discussed this before pretty much, but I'm going to go into what the nine say here regarding these particular questions. And I'm actually believing that these questions are coming from things that other teachers have said. So I'm not discrediting any other teacher, any other spiritual teacher, truth leader, channel, psychic, whatever. But the information, I'm looking at the questions that I'm being given about that information and then putting those questions into one and presenting them to the nine and bringing the nine forward in order to clarify, because there is so much confusion in the spiritual and truth community right now about what's happening. So, okay, first of all, the hybrid program. Is it true that humans on Earth are calling in and welcoming a gray hybrid AI Borg type of consciousness? Okay, and this is what the nine replied. Yes, through the action of taking the juice, this is what they do when they take the juice. They give permission for the Borg AI consciousness to come into this planetary reality. This can be rescinded, however, through realization of the action and a sovereign stance to cease continuation of participation in the juice program and the full surrender and commitment to the spiritual path. For those that do not rescind permission through realization and awareness, then they continue to give permission. This could be seen as a calling, despite the fact that this was a hijack and a manipulation. It was still undertaken via their own free will. Force and extreme coercion are not the same acts, and the latter is still part of free will. Hence the reason the dark structures want and need the action to be taken through choice and not through force. When we speak of force, we mean physically forcing, not through laws, rules, and regulations. Now, if you are asking if there are actual humans on Earth literally asking for literal gray or artificial intelligence or hybrid consciousness, Borg consciousness, to come into this reality, then the answer to this is also yes. However, in your current now time period, in your year that you call 2022, this is most rare indeed. These souls, the gray, the AI, the Borg hybrid consciousness, are fourth dimensional. And those that call them in are fourth dimensionally magically working souls. The hybridization program was something put into place several years ago on your planet. And whilst there was some success with this program, from the dark structure's perspective, it was not a success in the way it was intended to be. The hybrid consciousness was not a match for human incarnation into the human vehicle, even though the souls who were caught in the reincarnational trap due to a fail-safe system that was predominantly a dormant crystalline strand of DNA. So the hybrid consciousness was not a match for human incarnation into the human vehicle, even through the souls caught in that trap, because there was a fail-safe system in place, a dormant crystalline strand of DNA. If the hybridization program had been put into place as reincarnation, without some adaptation of the human vehicle's DNA system, then the hybrid consciousness would have been noticed immediately at birth due to a minor but striking difference in appearance. So had these souls managed to come into a human vehicle, they would have been spotted when they were born, because the vehicle would have a noticeable, minor but striking difference in appearance. The nine didn't say what the difference in appearance was. The JUICE programme is now the means in which the dark structures intend to create compatible vehicles for AI Borg Grey hybrid organic incarnations. So I'm talking about here, the nine are talking about here, AI organic hybrids. So they're partly AI and partly organic hybrid fused together. The chances of success on a wide scale on your planet with this program is currently below 20%. And regarding critical mass, the chances are below 5%. However, the small percentage creates the potential as a timeline for Earth, and the dark structures are doing all they can to prepare the societal structures throughout your planet for this eventuality. So the dark structures are preparing our, in the village, Gloria Love and her fey companions, the overlords are doing all they can to prepare the village societal structure throughout all domains for this eventuality, even though at critical mass, it's below 5% and the chances of it actually working on a wide scale are below 20%. This is the creation of androgynous societal acceptance. Even this societal structure has only chances at manifesting in part and will be set up throughout a bifurcated reality and will not be present in the other part of the bifurcation. So as the reality bifurcates, only one part of reality will have this in it and the other part will not. Now, the nine didn't confirm this, but I'm assuming that New Earth does not have this androgynous societal acceptance in an AI Borg hive mind scenario in the way that the other part of the bifurcated village will have. So those individuals in New Earth will bear witness and observe, but they won't be experientially part of that because the reality is bifurcated. So whilst the answer to your question is yes, the chances of succeeding in the intended methods regarding this is extremely low. However, the chances of partly succeeding is higher, but still low. So, okay, next question. Is it true that Earth has died and all humans who believe they are now resident on Earth are existing upon a vacation planet? This planet is no longer Earth in the village. It's a vacation planet because Earth died. So this is what the nine said. In the way this question is presented, the response must be no, for the truth is not literal as is spoken here. However, it is true that your Earth has, if you will, died in inverted commas, yet the more appropriate term to use would be transitioned. The Earth you knew in previous years was fully third dimensional. Your Earth you reside upon now is predominantly fourth dimensional. In part, it's still third dimensional. In part, it's fifth dimensional, but predominantly it is fourth dimensional. Your Earth is in transition, for one grand cycle has ended and the new grand cycle specific to the overall grand cycle has not yet begun. So indeed you are, if you will, at the in-between stages, which is the transition phase, the bridge, or the fourth dimension. When it comes to expressing this in density, your Earth is still in third density, but holds a fourth density geological template, which is a pre-matter blueprint for new geological manifestation. So what the nine is saying there is, the actual geology of the village and all the domains is going to change, and that there is a template held, which is a blueprint for this new geological manifestation that takes place over time. So third density is the geology, fourth dimension is the frequency, the energy of the consciousness of the planet, the village. I'm just going to have a sip of water. My throat isn't completely 100% back to normal, since my summer cold. Regarding the vacation planet, so someone is saying we're now on a vacation planet. Regarding the vacation planet, your Earth has always been, for billions of years and eons, it has been a vacation planet for cosmic travelers as a stopover, as it holds a very central place within the cosmic highway. This is a system of transportation throughout the cosmos, the galaxy. One must go through Earth to access other systems, if you will. However, third dimensional Earth has been quarantined until your 2012 cosmic moment, the winter solstice of 2012. So vacations and stopovers were forbidden before that, despite a few travelers ignoring that law. Now in your year of 2022, more and more cosmic travelers are entering your planetary domain. And due to its fourth dimensional nature and quarantine being lifted, then your planet Earth is returning to its former glory as the jewel planet, or the vacation planet, if you will. So can you see where the statement Earth has died and you're now on a vacation planet is actually true? It's just so simply and literally interpreted that it gives an incredibly false picture of what's actually going on. So this is where you have to interpret another speaker's subjective experience and their interpretation of the experience or the message. So I had to go to the nine to actually be given the accuracy of this. So this person, whoever it is that is saying Earth has died and we're now on a vacation planet, they're telling the truth. They're not lying. But that statement, as I said, is so literal, it's so basic, that it presents a false picture, because Earth hasn't died and we're still on the same planet that we always were. But the nine are explaining, because the quarantine has been lifted, more and more cosmic travelers are coming here. Earth is returning to its former glory as the jewel planet, or the vacation planet. So it's become a vacation planet, but it's always been a vacation planet. It's just that quarantine has been lifted. I will just say, this speaker that's supposed to have said this, Earth has died and we're now on a vacation planet, I haven't heard any speaker say this. So it might well be that the speaker didn't say this. The speaker said what the nine are saying, and the interpretation of the listener interpreted what they were saying. So it's not always the speaker, it's the interpretation. And I often get the interpretation because people write to me and say, Magenta, so-and-so said this and so-and-so said that, is it true? Now, did that person actually say that? Maybe they did. Or has the interpreter interpreted what they said? And that's why I say research semantics and be very discerning and understand how to interpret frequency of someone else's subjectivity, because that's how you'll find the truth. So the nine go on to say, only in this context could you say that Earth has died and you now exist on a vacation planet. For context, it would be equally as true to say that Earth is thriving and you all exist on Earth as you always did. The lesson to be learned from such questions as these is to not get caught up within the polarity of subjective opinion from one cosmic conduit to another. That's what the nine said. Don't get caught up within the polarity of subjective opinion from one cosmic conduit to another. I know it's difficult, but that's the nine's objective advice. It's what I try to do as much as I possibly can, listening to them and learning from them. Now, as you can probably hear, my throat is starting to sort of give up. So luckily, I'm almost at the end of this video. So the next topic is the great solar flash. And the nine have spoken on this before. It's been mentioned in my book, Infinite Helix and the Emerald Flame. And I believe in a couple of videos, but presented this question to the nine, because this is another big one that's out there and that I'm being asked about at the moment by lots of people. So here we go. And this is specific to the JUICE program, which wasn't in the other messages from the nine, because it was pre-attempted village takeover situation in the fictional novel. So is it accurate to say that there is going to be a huge solar flash, and when it occurs, it will neutralize all the damage done by the JUICE? It will take away all negative components of the JUICE within nice, good, honest people who did not take the JUICE willingly. So that's the question. And this is what the nine replied. It is accurate to say this, yes, when presenting this metaphor for your current situation on your planet. It is not accurate to present this as a literal event, as is expressed in your quest. The huge solar flash, or the great solar flash, is on the one hand metaphorical for the crystalline light that activates within you now as you move from carbon-based to crystalline-based life forms. The flash of light is metaphoric for the accompanying epiphanies and life-changing realizations that occur as you go through this transformation. So too is this metaphoric for the plasmic biological particles of photonic light that emanate forth from the grand central sun, galactic core, and fill your Earth's atmosphere and biosphere. These present also as that which you know as solar flare from Sol, your physical sun. The manifestation in matter of the fractalized grand central suns that emanate in matching replica, repeat from the light of source. These in linear time occur over a period of time. You may know this as the time you move into the light, the photon belt, the golden age, or Kali Yuga. From the higher perspective, this flash of light as crystalline activation, human mind, brain, epiphany, photonic light, plasma galactic codes, and solar flares occurs in one moment as a grand cosmic reset, as the cycles all move back to the original point, galactic alignment, and begin again anew. This can be seen, felt, understood, and processed by those who are aware of higher consciousness and non-linear time. But to perceive this through the linear third dimensional lens will lead you into a savior program belief system. For this one solar flash moment is not literal from the third dimensional perspective. Regarding the neutralization of the JUICE program, indeed, this is the case for those very rare few who commit fully to the spiritual path and move into the integral sovereign self through dedication and physical detoxification. So too is this the case for those who go through the rebirthing of soul regenesis. For so too in this situation is the JUICE components eradicated from the consciousness of the new soul. Yet presented in linear fashion as a solar cleansing en masse to all those souls who stand in innocence as passive experiencers of such a solar cleansing. This is an erroneous and incorrect interpretation of said events, of said event or series of events. So again, you can see how saying that a big flash of light or solar flash is going to wipe out all the damage from the JUICE within good people. You can see how that is true, but again, it is so basic, it has been interpreted so literally that it gives a false presentation. And for people to believe that this is literal, that a big solar flare is going to cover the Earth and wipe out all the JUICE damage, is extremely ungrounded thinking, to put it nicely. We really, really need to ground ourselves in reality. Yes, we're going into a sci-fi, Star Trek, Star Wars reality, but that has to be grounded within the laws of physics of this reality. So the nine have explained how this epiphany, this flash of light, this crystalline activation, and these solar flares, from the perspective of the higher consciousness, it happens in a split second. It's a great big flash of light. It wipes out all damage. That is exactly what happens. But down here in the third dimension, in the physical reality, this takes place over a long, long, long period of time and is a series of epiphanies and solar flash events. There isn't just one literal flash that's going to wipe out everyone's trauma and disease and juice damage in one moment. That's higher perspective. So yet again, there's truth there, but whoever is putting this out there, whoever is making this claim, is not able to be the objective observer of their own subjectivity. So that's what the nine said. And they do actually bring in regenesis as part of that, as a metaphor for that. Regenesis is the cleansing, because as they say here, so too is this the case for those who go through the rebirthing of soul, regenesis, for so too in this situation is the juice components eradicated from the consciousness of the new soul. So the flash of light is actually their reincarnation and going through the regenesis program as they create, if you will, a new beginning of individualized consciousness, a new spark for individualized consciousness without any juice damage at all. But on a literal level, that doesn't happen while they're here in this reality. They have to pass from this physical body and go through that. So there are multiple, multiple ways of looking at this. And so really, it's not necessarily up to the speaker to understand this, because the speaker is delivering. If someone has actually said this, and it isn't an interpretation from listeners, I've heard this from a lot of people. So I would imagine someone is actually out there making this claim. A person making this claim, they are doing the best that they can within what they know. They've been given this information, whether it's come from communing with extraterrestrials on a ship or channeling or telepathy, or do they have a psychic insider somewhere, whatever, however they're getting this information, they are most likely, not above 90%, the probability that this person genuinely believes what they're saying. And it's true if basic and third dimensional and linear, it still has its source in truth. So they believe what they're saying. So when they're imparting all this to you, they're sharing their knowledge, and they think that they're doing something really good. And, you know, they are, because if it wasn't for people that weren't able to interpret their own messages, then you wouldn't be given the chance to be discerning and to learn how to interpret. So you have to be presented with all these different ways of presenting the message in order for you to learn. And that's what it's all about. It's about you, the individual. So the individual giving this information, I mean, yes, on the one hand, perhaps they should do more spiritual work. Perhaps they should have been in this journey longer, but that's not for me to judge, and I'm not going to. They're doing what they think is right. The chances of them deliberately misleading you are pretty low. However, there are people out there that do that. But my feeling is that this person, whoever it is that said this, isn't doing this deliberately. They believe what they're saying. And as I said, there's truth there. It's just a basic literal interpretation of something that is true, but multidimensional. And it's all multidimensional. That's what's happening right now. We're moving into a multidimensional reality. Our consciousness is becoming multidimensional. We must decode everything from that perspective. So what I'm saying is, it's not necessarily their role, their job, to learn more. And you can't force yourself to have more of an insight than you have. They think that they're sharing and doing a good thing. It is your job as the listener to interpret what they are saying, to take on board what they have said, have discernment. Don't necessarily throw it away, throw the baby out with the bathwater and decide that they're, you know, a deep state operative and that they're here to mislead everyone. Make your decision. Could this be a misinterpretation of something? Could this be a metaphor? Could this be true in some form? So take that on board and go through an analysis yourself using your discernment, and then learn how to interpret the subjective experience that that individual has gone through. So if they say to you, I walked through the wall and I saw an extraterrestrial, and the extraterrestrial gestured to me to get into a ship and off I went, does that mean that person is telling lies? Well, maybe, but then equally, that person could really have experienced that. And that's their subjective experience. And they could really believe they walked through the wall. Were they in their astral body at the time? You can walk through walls in your astral body. So we need to look at what they're saying, discern whether this is disinformation or sensationalism, trying to get views or make money from this, or are they actually genuinely believing what they're saying? And then we look at the frequency that they were given when they tried to interpret this subjective experience, and look at what might have actually have happened. So you need to look at the messenger themselves and feel whether they are honest, and do they have a good heart, an open heart? Or is there something nefarious there? Is there traumas there? Is there something that is not in alignment there? And then when you've decided the messenger themselves as to where they are and how accurate they may be within their own subjectivity, then you decide what that subjective experience may actually mean. That's all part of your discernment. And that's what this whole thing is about. And this is why there's so much confusion out there right now, and so many different things being said in the spiritual communities and in the truth communities, because we are all waking up to our own subjectivity. We are all going through these experiences one way or another. And it's not always easy to be objective to our own subjective experience. We have to take ourselves outside of ourselves somewhat and look at our experience from a different standpoint in order to evaluate it. And if you can do that, if you can really do that, then you will find truth. So I'd just like to say thank you very much for listening today. Thanks for bearing with me with my voice not being 100%. And I hope I've helped with some of your questions. So sending lots of love, and I will see you all again soon. Bye.